All right, welcome to another episode of The InEVitable. This is MotorTrend's podcast on the future of mobility, the future of the car. What are we going to be driving in the future? How will we be driving it if maybe they don't have steering wheels? Where the pedals are going to be? Where are we going to sit? How are we going to hail it? Joined as ever with my stunning, fabulous, bearded co-host, Johnny Lieberman. Hi, Johnny.
I noticed people without beards can never grow to the fact that somebody else has
a beard.
I can't
grow a beard.
I'm just saying,
I got the hair thing going now, though. It's awesome.
Yes.
Today's guest is our next door neighbor at Motor Trend headquarters, world headquarters in El Segundo, California. It is the founder, majority stakeholder in Fisker Inc., Henrick Fisker.
Yeah.
Very excited to chat with this guy. If you don't, you might know the name Fisker. This guy's been around for a long time. If you are a real car fan, you will know him as a designer of some iconic vehicles at BMW, at Aston Martin, before he went off and did a lot of his own kinds of coach building startups.
And then he did the Fisker Karma.
Right.
And this is a vehicle, and I find this one interesting because it is a stunning design, and that design has spanned three car companies.
Yep.
So it was the Fisker Karma, it was the VLF, whatever it was called, and then it became
VLF
the
Automotive.
And then it became
Karma.
The Karma Rivero.
Right.
It's still going. So it's such a strong design. It's been in production continuously, basically, we're getting on 10 years.
More than that.
12.
Ten years. Yep.
But I mean, three companies. So I think that's sort of almost unprecedented. I mean, maybe like the BMW iZeta, but they were all kind of like they just kept getting pushed around. You know, like somebody else would build the iZeta in different countries. But it's just weird. Three separate companies consecutively have kept this design alive.
Right. And if you don't know the car, it's a good chance especially in a coastal city.
Google's Fisker Karma.
Fisker Karma. It's got a big mustache.
Big kind of mustache,
like the Pringles
big,
mustache.
Big, sexy, low slung sedan.
Right. It was rapped about in Donald Glover's song. He raps about the Fisker Karma. It's a pretty funny rhyme, actually. Johnny's gonna be like, I don't know what you're talking about.
Nope, don't know what you're talking about.
But yeah, it started with basically a Volt powertrain on top of a big body four-door luxury sedan, and then they ripped all that out when Fisker Automotive went bankrupt, and VLF was this new company that one of my heroes, Bob Lutz, was involved with, and they just stuffed they stuffed V8s
and
into
V10.
It. The V10 is actually a Viper-based car. That's where Fisker
was.
It was the Force 10 or Force 1 or something, whatever.
Yeah.
But then, as Johnny mentions, out of the ashes of Fisker Automotive, Karma, Karma
down
company.
Down in Irvine. I think they have Chinese money behind them.
Well, the assets, when Henrik Fisker left Fisker Automotive, a Chinese company called Wangsheng Automotive bought basically at a fire sale everything else. And I think that eventually became Karma Rivero, whatever. So it's a stunning design. Henrik has cut his teeth on designing beautiful cars.
Well, that's the other thing too. I mean, like this, you know, if you're a car geek like I am, like it's cool. We're doing the InEVitable.
Like we are.
I'd rather just do a straight car design show, given my druthers.
No, that's great. You know, what a great medium.
Yeah.
Let's talk about design.
Yeah. Yes, it's fantastic. It's like ventriloquism on the radio.
Right.
But this guy did the BMW Z8. Yeah. He did the Aston Martin DB9 and the Aston Martin Vantage, the last generation. And those are three of the better looking cars designed in the last 25 years.
Future future classics.
Yeah.
They're already classics.
They'll be on the lawn at Pebble.
Right.
You know, the Z8 might already be on the lawn. I mean, it's that good looking. It's just an incredible looking car. Forget about how they drive, whatever. Just the way they look. So this guy can design good looking things. And now his new company, they're doing the Ocean.
Yep.
Fisker Ocean. It's a small SUV. I think it's based on the Jag I-Pace platform.
Built by Magna.
Built in Austria. Austria. Magna Steyr, where they build the G-Wagon and a bunch of other stuff. Toyota Supra.
And but it's an EV. It's a pure EV.
Yeah.
It's inevitable. It's coming.
Yeah.
It's got, there's three versions of the Ocean.
Up to 350 miles of range. Solar panels on the roof, finally.
They say it'll get, if you charged it via solar panels, you get up to 2,000 miles of range in a year, which is not bad.
I'll take it. That's 10 charging sessions, essentially.
Right.
Remember, a lot of people don't know this, but you never really charge to 100%. You charge to like 70-80%.
Right.
So yeah, that's 10 sessions.
Unique about this EV startup is they're not doing the moonshot a super expensive luxury
first.
Car first, yeah. They are doing the high volume, much more affordable vehicles as their one and their two vehicles. So the first one, this Ocean, the base model called the Ocean Sport should retail under $40,000 with front wheel drive and about 250 miles of range. And then the second car called the Pear is going to be even
Which we know nothing cheaper. About. But what's cool, the Ocean finally, because I've had a lot of people weirdly asking me, what about the Fisker Ocean? I'm like, I don't know, I've never seen it. But then he, on his Instagram.
Just got the first test unit.
It's running around LA. It's running got around. Paint on it. Yeah. We'll ask him about that.
And it's great. It was a natural to get him here. Again, Fisker's headquarters is right around the corner from MotorTrend's world headquarters in beautiful. I think we're in El Segundo. They're technically in Manhattan Beach, which is weird.
I think we're technically in Hawthorne, but anyway.
No, we're actually in El Segundo. but then we helped them do the launch. Actually, I don't know if you can tell. Yeah, we helped them do the launch of the Ocean on the Manhattan Beach Pier, which I attended, which is actually really cool because my understanding is nobody gets to use. The pier is state property and it took a lot of legal finagling permits and stuff that our events team did to do this cool event last year at the LA Auto Show on the pier, and of course the Ocean car in front of the ocean. I mean, and to do that on. they made some big donation to something like Surf Rider to preserve the ocean,
heal the bay,
right? So it was great. It actually looked really cool. All the press images, if you go onto their site, are going to show the ocean in front of the ocean. But yeah, Fisker, excited to talk to him. I've met him a couple times. He's a trip.
Yeah, and it is interesting that you have an exterior designer, like CEO of a company that doesn't really like. Yeah, engineers. Okay, that makes a little sense. But like, I'm just trying to think. Like, you know, like Tom Gale was a board member at Chrysler. Merrick Reichman might be the power behind the throne at Aston Martin in some ways. But I'm just like,
it's a good question.
You know, like a designer, a body guy. You know what I mean? Like a man who, you know, painting clay models in school is now a CEO. So it's interesting. It's fascinating. Right.
Means he knows something. So why don't we find out?
All right,
bring him on.
So hey, got Henrick Fisker sitting right here. And before we get into Ed's usual kind of deep dive, creepy, you know, stalkery. We saw on your Instagram account that you had the first Fisker Ocean test vehicle just land in LA like 2 or 3 days ago.
Like the one, the only?
Well, it's the first one we didn't put camouflage on.
Okay.
First with paint.
First with paint. And the others are painted, but we put camouflage because, as you know, early test vehicles are never the high quality that you expect. And even this one is, from my taste, still not 100% there. It's still a prototype built. But it was a lot of fun taking it out in the 405. I mean, that's where you do the real testing, you know?
Yep.
All that uneven surfaces.
Right.
Yep. And then eventually you're going to have to hit some potholes with it as well.
So how is it?
You love it?
I love it. It's amazing. I mean, how can I not, you know? Right. But you know, we spend a lot of time fine-tuning the vehicle and... I don't know if it's usual, but we actually have a race car driver that helps us, a female race car driver out of the UK, Abby Eaton.
Oh, yeah, and, She's
been helping setting it up, and because I want a really sporty, fun drive. You know, I'm a car guy.
Sure.
But then we also have to balance it with how is it to drive every day to work, you know, on the freeway, on the side streets and all that. And that's kind of why, of course, we have the vehicle here as well, because you can test it on a test track where they have all the different surfaces, but there's nothing like going out, you know, on the real roads in the real conditions, and you always find some unusual thing, and you just gotta have to feel
especially
that.
On LA freeways, which are just, you know, more heavily trafficked than anywhere else in this country, at least.
But which one did you bring it? Is it a Sport, Ultra, or
it's an Extreme?
It's Extreme. Yeah. So that's the top level, two motor, 550 horsepower, 350 mile range. Right?
350 mile range. It should do
solar panels on the roof.
Solar panels. Got 0 to 60 in about 3.5 seconds.
Okay.
So I did punch it, and it felt really good. I mean, that thing is just flying. And I even had, I think, a Manhattan policeman waving at me. I wasn't sure if he was waving because he thought it was cool or he told me to calm down.
Right.
It might have been the second.
But you have test vehicle all over, right? So are you getting, I mean, you've had what, 4 or 5 days now?
Just a few days. Yeah.
So are people stopping you? Are you getting wave flight, you know, asking about it?
Yeah, they kind of roll down the window and go, what's that? Right. Yeah. Never seen that before. Right. What is that?
Then my favorite is, because I have a Rivian, and people go, what is that? I go, it's a Rivian. Who makes it? Rivian.
Yeah.
What is that?
Yeah. I know. But it keeps coming. I mean, I think people are starting to get used to that. We don't only have Toyotas and Fords. You know, there's other new brands as well.
Right. Let me ask you this. I've always wanted to ask someone this question. It's impossible to do. What's it like driving a car with your name on it?
It's kind of weird. I mean, specifically if people start getting in conversation, I don't really tell who I am. So it's quite fun, actually, once in a while. But yeah, no, it's obviously a great feeling. It's been, you know, a lot of work. I've had a lot of ups and downs in my career. Right. And, you know, it took a long time to get to this point. We got a fantastic team, of course, behind it, some great partners. So it's an unbelievable feeling. And you know, we had it at the office today. We got everybody in and out burgers and just had a great time, you know, just admiring sort of how far we have come. And it's an amazing time, I think, in automotive history to see kind of the birth of all these brands and new cars. Nothing is super exciting, actually.
Well, you jumped ahead. I was going to ask this. I was asking a version of the same question, which is, so your current company, the newest is Fisker Inc. You had Fisker Automotive. And one of the questions I had, because we are still going to go through your sort of trajectory and talk about some of these ups and downs. Didn't you learn? Like, why would you put your name on the company? Right. I actually looked up other people who have used their name on their company and subsequently lost like the IP. Either
Steve Saleen.
They got bought out or they left the company and something went. And a lot of it happens in the fashion industry, like, you know, Paul Smith or whoever. Like these guys end up like, oh man, I'm no longer at the company. And look at the direction. It's Calvin Klein. I mean, he no longer is control of the design of the clothes.
Yves Saint Laurent,
Yeah, exactly. Well, I think they took it after he died. Oh. But like, you know, you did it once. You could have named it anything else, you know.
Well, first, let me say, it definitely, once you're taking such a tough beating, I guess it feels like getting punched out in round 12 as a boxer and, you know, getting knocked out and you wake up and go, what the hell happened? And everything hurts. And then nobody picks up the phone. Nobody wants to talk to you and you're out of the ring. However, you know, when I started again, I think that it's sort of an incredible experience to have started a car company. And it's not something you can learn or take a lesson in or go to school and learn. Mm. So I think that experience was also what ultimately really was something which I think our first investors appreciated, because once you understand this capital intensive business, you realize that it's easy to lose a lot of money. It's easy to make mistakes. That means you have to fire people or do a whole bunch of different things. So I think as we started sort of 2.0, there was a couple of things that I had learned, which I really took with me. And you mentioned, you know, all these other fashion names and so on that suddenly didn't own the company. And it was kind of the same with Fisker 1.0. I never really owned that company. I had my name on it, but I never had majority. I never owned it. There was always a whole bunch of other investors making many decisions. So when we set up Fisker Inc., it set up in a way where I have full control of the decision and the company. And I think it has shown so far that we have done extremely well. We haven't had to lay off any people. We haven't delayed the SOP. So a lot of these are lessons learned that came in. And then I think that, you know, we also had quite a following of the Fisker Karma. You know, there's still a couple of thousand cars out there. Mm-hmm. And I think for some people, it's been a bit of a cult vehicle. And I think that also helped that we didn't have to build a brand from zero. Right. There was somewhat of a start. People knew we could design a cool car. You know, one of the things we didn't have to do that I think every other EV startup had to do, you know, is starting with a super luxury car, because you kind of have to prove, hey, we can make an amazing, super expensive, super fast.
Like what Lucid's doing right now.
Yeah. No, everybody. I mean, Fisker 1.0, we did the Karma. Tesla did the Model S.
Right.
But reality is that what you really want to start by doing is actually doing a high volume vehicle, where you earn a ton of money so you can afford making all these expensive vehicles. Because the truth is, you know, you don't make that much money making these super luxury cars. It's not enough to pay for, you know, the development of multiple high-end, high-volume vehicles. And you can see it today with the luxury manufacturers, you know, how they've been bought up, the small sports car companies by all the big ones, because you can't survive just making super luxury cars. I mean, I worked for Aston Martin for many years. And I think when I was there for the first time, we made profit. I think it was $50 million.
Yeah.
And we had the highest selling Aston Martin ever, which were the Vantage, the first generation. But what are you going to do with $50 million? You can't develop a new car for that. So we had that possibility now with Fisker Inc. to start with the Ocean. I didn't have to prove to anybody I could design a cool, sexy sports car because I've done a lot of them.
You've done that, yeah.
And Fisker already did the Karma. So I think that gave us sort of a unique entrance point in the market, which nobody else has really done as an EV startup.
Well, I'll tell you, this is also a question of mine, and I give you mad respect because we actually talked about it with other guests. I think we talked about Zinger. Like, why go after the high? I mean, that car's like $2 million. Like, why start there? And of course, you told me the answer that I've heard from everybody else, which is, well, you build the brand, you develop the buzz around the halo. It's expensive. You know, your narrative is like 180 degrees from everybody else. They're going to say that the first car is going to be expensive. We're going to have a good margin on it, and then we will sew that back into the volume, the lower price volume models. This is sort of Lucid's approach. Mm-hmm. They've talked about how
100%,
not only that, the technology, they can deliver the most power, the most range, at this highest cost, and then kind of dial everything back. So I am fascinated because, for you guys who don't know, Fisker Inc., Henrick's first car, the Ocean, the sport model, will retail under $40,000. And then the follow-up vehicle, which very little detail is on, was called the Pear. That was supposed to retail under $30,000 before any incentives kick in. So these are like, that 40,000 people have been flirting with. Tesla claimed to deliver a $35,000 vehicle that kind of
it never really happened, but it's close. Yeah.
F-150 Lightning is going to be at supposedly, you know, the Ford Pro 39, who knows. But nobody has really talked about, I mean, yeah, there's a
Chevy Bolt and 27 Leaf, now.
But those are sort of Gen 1
technology. Yeah, not long range.
So I applaud you coming in at the volume. I love the cheap car. I want people to get, you know, the most number of people to enjoy and experience new technology. But I'm a little suspicious because your narrative is very different from other startups. Everybody's going for the 100K. Rivian's truck is now 90,
yeah,
95, 99.
Yeah, you know,
Lucid's, all of them so far, have been over 100,000.
Yeah, yeah.
So how does the
How are you doing
how many,
this?
Yeah, how are you gonna? How many you have to sell to make this work? You
know? Well, so I think first this narrative that you're mentioning that you start with an expensive car and you make a ton of money to make the next vehicles. Like I said, it is not really true, and I think some people will figure this out. I've been in that business. I've been with Aston Martin for many years. Yes, you make a lot of money per car, but you're not selling hundreds of thousands.
Yeah.
And secondly, the type of customer care you have to spend on somebody who's buying a $150,000 car eats a lot into the profit. And finally, you're not going to get any good pricing with any suppliers making vehicles. You know, you make 10, 20, 30,000 a year. That's why, you know, that you see the high volume makers are able to make these low cost gasoline cars because they're making them in the millions.
Right.
So what's missing in the EV segment is anybody making vehicles in the hundreds of thousands except for Tesla. So, you know, when we went out, how do we do it? Of course, we don't want to give the recipe away to everybody, but the high-level, answer is that, first of all, we went out to source the Fisker Ocean with expected volumes eventually well over 100,000 vehicles.
And that's global. That's
global.
Global.
Okay. But we are planning to, you know, eventually, I mean, we're selling it in U.S. and Europe. We're planning to sell it in China. Magna already has a joint venture in China with manufacturing.
Oh, they do.
So it's a possibility that we go with them in China.
Magna is a company in Graz, Austria, and they're known for, they make the G Wagon there, and Renaults and
Toyota Supra, etc.
Yeah, right. And so this is where the Ocean's being manufactured.
Yeah. Yep. So the misconception is all. I mean, the other point here is manufacturing, right? I mean, people often say, well, why don't you just make your own plant? You can make it a lot cheaper. Why do I think I can make a car cheaper than somebody who's manufactured cars for 70 years, right? I mean, there's a reason Toyota went to Magna. If Magna wasn't competitive, Toyota wouldn't go there and get built the Supra,
right?
They have to make high quality. They have to make it for the right price. Now, to manufacture a car is not like half the cost of the car. You know, it's less than 10%.
Right.
So even if I can, you know, save 10% of that 10%, you're talking about maybe saving $500, but you first have to learn how to manufacture a car. And so far, there's no EV startup that has scaled up perfectly like an OEM because they have to first learn to make it the car. So I think we're taking that risk out. So when we are working with Magna, from the first day, I'm only paying a fixed manufacturing fee. So if Magna, right, instead of taking X amount of hours to do it, they now take triple, I don't pay for that because they're the specialist.
Right. Mm.
So we are taking the risk out of not getting a quality car. We are taking the risk out of not getting the right pricing or the cost to manufacture the car from day one, which means we have the right profit in our vehicle from day one. Most of the time when you're an EV startup, you don't have profits in the beginning because you're spending more time assembling these vehicles, so ultimately eats into the profits.
Well, you went over something, though. That assumes, though, you show up on day one with Magna producing your car with as close to perfect plan for their production. Because if something's on your end and you didn't figure something out, the costs are going to get pushed back on you, right?
No, that's not how it works, because we started developing this car together with Magna 2 years ago.
Okay.
So it's not like we're taking a product, throwing it over a wall, saying, hey, make it, and then Magna, oh, shit, it's too difficult. No, they worked with us.
Okay.
We know it already. They already are producing cars since beginning of this year. So what's different also with Magna is that if I had to build my own factory, most likely my prototypes would not be built at the factory.
Right.
If you look at all the EV startups, most likely their prototypes are built somewhere else because the factory isn't ready.
Right.
In this case, Magna already have a factory, so our prototypes are built in the factory by the people who's going to build the car.
For instance, Lucid, like they built, hand-built about, I don't know what it was, 150 vehicles in California, but the factory was always in Arizona. So they had to like have the people from Casa Grande come up. They're training them there, they're sending them back, but everything's different. But I have a question, looking at a larger thing. So, today, if you're building a new car, and you're saying manufacturing is maybe 10%, what is the cost to develop a new model? Not start a new car company, but like, I'm going to build a new car. I have a brand. What's that cost these days?
Well, I think it depends whether you're an established OEM or a startup. Startup definitely can do it for less money simply because they have less people,
right?
And they have to make it faster. Otherwise, you can't survive. So one of the first things we did, we looked at changing the traditional development process. And that turned out to be a lot more difficult than we thought, because it wasn't enough that we did it. We then went out to suppliers and said, hey, we can make a car in 2.5 years. And they go, hold on a minute, it takes 4 years.
Right.
And here's the process. And we go, no, we got to cut out 1.5. So that was already a major task that we spent a lot of time, specifically in 19 and 2020, as we were starting up the whole process. And we then, of course, convinced Magna, let's do this together. And with Magna sort of together, we went out to suppliers and said, hey, do you want to be part of the future? Do you want to be part of making a car that can be, in 2.5 years? And everybody says, yes, let's do it. Then, of course, we had to commit to extremely tight process where we sign off things super quick. For example, there's days where I have to make a decision within the hour. I don't have time to have somebody goes back like you would at an OEM and come with three proposals in 3 weeks.
Go
and
to committee, everybody.
Committee.
Right.
We don't have time for that. And
focus
secondly,
groups.
We also kind of lucky because I designed the car, so I only get, a week to come up with the design, and then we have to finalize, and then there's no changes. So we don't have a flying chairman that comes in, which I've seen a lot, and suddenly goes, oh, I don't like that. Can we change the tail lamp? No, we already signed off the tooling. I don't care. I don't like it. Change it.
Yeah,
that is up to me not to do that, which I haven't. So that all that we were able to take out about 1.5 year of development time. That's a lot of money. So I would say normally in the business is probably somewhere between 1.5 to 2.5 billion to make a car from scratch. And we probably are a lot closer to a billion in the end of the day. And then, of course, on top of that, you have, and that's including the tooling and everything else.
Yep.
Now, of course, if we had to build a factory, we'd have to throw another couple of billions in there,
sure,
which
sure.
we didn't.
Right.
And the other thing is, if you build a factory, you normally would say, hey, eventually we want to make, let's say, 150,000 cars. So you size the factory to that. Then you start hiring the people. However, as you scale up, you may only make 1,000 cars a week or a month or whatever, but you're still paying for that giant factory from day one.
Sure.
So the overhead cost you have is gigantic. We have access to about 500,000 capacity. 500,000.
That's how big Magna is.
Well, no. It's just what Magna and Foxconn.
Foxconn.
We have Magna. They have well over 100,000. We have Foxconn. They could probably make 400,000 vehicles there.
Got it.
We don't have any cost right now. We're not paying for these factories, but we have negotiated access to that. We are working with both of these companies to make sure we can get volume going and get as fast as we can to 500,000 cars a year.
So, okay, but that's all. That's insane. That's amazing. So it's a billion, or you know, you're saving probably like 500,000 the way you're doing it. You didn't spend another couple of billion.
No, over a billion the way you're doing it.
Okay,
if you're saying it's a billion and it's
but
2.5.
This is still we're talking about the bending of the steel, the pouring of foundations for buildings. You're not doing. What about the software piece? Like we're going to start covering software defined vehicles and all of this amazing technology that's going to be unlocked. But the code, that takes some time. I mean, or how are you speeding up that process?
Yeah, so software is probably going to be the most vital part of future, I would say, car. I don't want to say only development, but also the whole integration and how the car works.
Yep.
It's all driven by software, whereas, you know, we grew up with maybe our dads went out and adjusted the carburetor. Those days are over.
Yeah, hit it with a wrench, yeah.
So you know, what we decided to do, first of all, our CTO, Bukart Honka, he is, you know, he came, first of all, he was 10 years with Volkswagen running e-mobility, and then he was 10 years with a company in Silicon Valley called Synopsys that actually developed and designed chips. So he comes from the chip industry. He is super into software. That's really, he's in his element when he's talking about software. And he's built an amazing team. Up in Silicon Valley, we have a facility up there we call Source Code.
Okay.
It's kind of our secret software development center.
Not anymore. Look it up, Source Code.
And then we have another facility in India, in Hyderabad, as well. And that's all software engineers there in San Francisco. So we do most of the software in-house. He is a believer that it's not about 1,000 people.
Yep.
It's about the right 10 to 20 people. And then, of course, you can give some of that coding to other companies, but you need to have the software architects in-house that lays out the strategy, that figures out how is this actually going to work. And that's what we have done in-house. And I think you'll be amazed when you see our entire user interface. We spend a lot of money on creating what I think is probably going to be the highest resolution screen in a car. You'll see it in November, 17.1 inch. So we did a lot of work. We then have a human interface team, which is quite large, which most of the people there are from companies like Microsoft, Apple, etc. Also, I don't know that I think we maybe have one or two people from the automotive industry. The rest is from the software industry. So we take this very serious. We see ourselves as a digital car company. You'll have to buy our cars from online or via our app. You'll make service appointments for our app. Of course, there's warranty on the vehicles for the first sort of 4 to 6 years. And so you don't need to go to any service area. We pick up the car, but everything is done digitally. Everything.
And how many engineers do you have, including the user interface team?
So we have
software engineers, I should say.
Well, I would say between engineers and software engineers, probably close to 500. Something like that.
So it's a big staff.
It's quite a big staff. We are very lean because we don't have, for example, we don't have a huge manufacturing staff. We have a few. Right. Some sits over in Magna. We just hired our senior VP of manufacturing, and he's laying out the strategy over how do we get to 1 million cars a year in production by 2000 or in 2027. So that's his task to kind of lay out what do we need to do to get there. And he's actually over in Europe right now.
That's ambitious. That's a
so let me, and you. You're going to be the first executive that I sort of probe on this, but this is going to be what I'm going to be asking people for the next 5 years. And feel free to say that's confidential. But who's your main chip supplier? Is it Qualcomm, NVIDIA? AMD?
So that is confidential.
Okay.
And I think I tell you the reason why, because everybody, of course, is flocking to get these chips, and we have. Yeah. A lot of shady people, the middlemen, they're selling these chips for sometimes 100 times the cost of these chips, which is crazy.
Yeah.
I think we have an advantage in, again, our partner Magna. which is the fourth largest supplier in the world. And we also use several other Magna companies that need chips. For example, it could be the mirrors. We use Magna mirrors, and there's chips in there because, you know, they have cameras and sensors and all that. So we, I think, with Magna support, we've been able to secure a supply of chips, which is why we haven't announced a delay in start of production. They have also ordered these. We actually went out to all our suppliers already last year, asked them to pre-order chips for 23. So I think in one way we were lucky we didn't have to launch a car either end of last year, beginning of this year, because that's probably the worst time.
Yep.
And then finally we have Foxconn.
Right,
which actually makes chips.
Right, right.
So along with like every iPhone and Apple device on the planet, so they have some specialty in dealing with high capacity, you know,
high quality
microchips in small portable devices. So yes, Foxconn, well known. What about how about cloud? Do you have a cloud partner?
We do.
Is it?
So again, you know, we don't really want to go out and tell because as soon as we do that, I'm sure they get 20 phone calls from, you know, our competitors. So I think nobody really do that, go out and say who is their partners. I think at this point in time, I mean, we have announced a few partners, for example, our battery partner, CATL, because we have a firm agreement also that allows us to increase capacity and all that. So we don't mind talking about that. We've got an amazing tire partner, Bridgestone.
Right.
But something like, you know, a few of these other...
Well, the big guys, like I'll tell you, the entrenched legacy car manufacturers, all they've, you know, we know who's working with whom because they want to be more positioned like a tech company. So they want to say, like, oh, we are with AWS or we're over here with Microsoft Azure. But I get it. And this is me learning, like, what can I ask?
Yeah, that's a good point. I mean, we're trying to learn, like, what questions to ask. Like, you know,
I can ask anything you want. I might just not answer.
Right.
Right. No, but I'm saying, I used to know how to say, like, oh, your exhaust valve filled with sodium. Like, not that means, but it sounded good. But now it's like,
But I don't know that it necessarily, you know, look, I think there's a lot of names getting thrown around, like you mentioned, with prove that you're sort of in the game.
Right.
But, you know, I don't know that for us, I don't think for us necessarily that has any value. I think for us the value is that we are partners that can deliver on time and that we have worked with for a long time. I mean, it's not like we went out, you know, yesterday and called somebody. This is obviously something that's gone on for the last 2 years to build these relationships. And like I mentioned, we have, of course, used Magna and Foxconn to help us build these relationships in certain areas. Other areas, we might have had these relationships ourselves. But I will tell you one unique thing, and that is, and that goes for not only startups, also traditional OEMs. What is happening today in certain industries is that it used to be that the OEMs would go and check out the supplier and make sure they liked them and make sure all kind of stuff, which we still do. Right. However, it's also reversed where the supplier looks at the OEM, whether it's traditional or startup, and saying, do we believe that you are going to hit SOP? Do we believe that you're going to hit this volume, startup production, and are you going to hit this volume? Why are they doing that? Because they've been burned over the last 3-4 years. Don't forget it was the OEMs that canceled the chips. That's why we have a chip shortage.
Right.
Because they canceled it.
They said no one's going to buy a car in the pandemic. Put them into TVs.
Exactly.
And, you know, so and then it was like, hey, we want them back.
Right, and we have the same issue with battery manufacturers that have been burned because OEM says, oh, we're going to make 100,000 of that car. Known OEMs. And it turned out they only made 20,000. So then they got burned because they set up all these lines. So we have this reverse thing where, you know, the suppliers come and they really want to know our business model. They want to see our vehicle. They want to. Why are we taking reservations? Because they want to see, can you actually sell these vehicles?
Right. But that's a bit of what's the expression? The tail wags the dog, right? It's kind of a little bit backwards. Well, but it is a weird, as you said, it's a weird spot in the history of the automobile.
So
you know,
by
the way, Ed's dying to get
No, this is great. We will get to the historical stuff. I did want to stay on this one because this is again my head is really into software defined vehicles, and I went to this really obscure German software conference, and it was all suppliers. It was Bosch, it was Continental, it was AMD was there, you know, BlackBerry, everybody, and we're talking. And it was the takeaway was a lot of the car companies, they're following kind of they've embraced finally or looked at the Tesla model where it's sort of fully vertically integrated. The software system in particular everything was designed from the start to talk to each other, same language, same microprocessors, everything, blah, blah, blah. And that kind of, one expert I talked to said it creates a platform for creativity. When everything speaks the same language and it's the same software, it's the same engineers designing it, you can do all these things. You can add fart mode 5 years later, right? You can put video games in the car. And this is stuff that these legacy guys are only now wrapping their heads around. When I hear that you are finding a path with a lot of suppliers, how, first of all, does that thesis hold water? Do you need to be fully vertically integrated? Is it possible to do it with a lot of your production reliant on strong legacy, you know, supplier relationships, or is it, you know, or do you, or I don't know, like, am I wrong?
Yeah, I think it doesn't really work like that. I don't think it has anything to do with whether it's suppliers. It's something to do with how you set up your electrical architecture from the beginning. And I think historically what happened, or historically, I think over the last sort of maybe, let's say 10 years, maybe 7-8 years, what happened was we had this big transformation. And of course, the legacy automakers could not just dump everything they had and say, okay, we'll start from afresh. They had to patch the existing and see how do we get to the new. And that obviously will take longer and it won't be as great as if you can just say, let's forget it, we'll start on a clean sheet of paper.
Right.
Now, somebody like us at Fisker, we start on a clean sheet of paper, but it doesn't mean that you're not using, I mean, everybody uses suppliers, even some companies that claim they're fully 100% vertically integrated, everybody uses suppliers, and we know it because we go and go, you also deliver to those guys up in, you know, Silicon Valley, great. So it's not about whether you use suppliers, it's about whether you have the foundation of a fully integrated architecture that allows you to be fully in control, and you then tell suppliers, here's what I need for you, from you. You got to do this to make it work within the system. So I think it's going back out to the supplier and giving them a futuristic view of what you need. What happened in the past is that the suppliers were just told to patch up the last old stuff, and that becomes a patch up, and there's nothing you can do about it. But I think now with the future and where we're going in the future, what is very important is after you have, I mean, you have that strategy of saying, okay, clean sheet of paper, here's what we're going to do. What my experience has been in many large companies is that you start having these silos where some engineers over there works on that. Then you got some designers working on this. Then you got some suppliers. Mm-hmm. So for example, when we come together at Fisker, we sit in our what we call seating box, which essentially is an interior of a car with all the electronics, even the speakers, the screens. And we spend 2 hours, several times a week, where we go through functions. And in that meeting is not just the software engineers and the programmers. There's also the human experience team. There's the designers. There's even Colin Material. I was there the other day. And our director of interior design said, you know, something with that color, that needs to be toned a bit. And they go, oh, yeah. And what about that down there? So you have everybody giving their input. And so what it's really about is a fundamental change within the car industry where you can't anymore have one group develop something and then it arrives over in the human experience group and they go, hold on a minute. Why did you? Because don't forget, if you program a certain button to work this way, and then you have to go in a menu, and then you have to press another button. By the time it gets to the user interface people, they go, why do we need 3 steps? You could have done it in 2.
Right.
And then it's too late. Right. So you that's know, why it, when you see some test cars now from very established OEMs, you still have journalists going, but why did they do it like that? Well, because it was made from one department, and then when it reached the other, it was too late.
And if you stop and think about it, it's obvious. Like, I'm driving the new GTI right now. And, you know, a lot of complaints. We've complained. Everyone's complained about the user interface.
CEO might have gotten fired.
Yeah, CEO might have just been fired. But it's like you can see that in action. Like, you know, if the actual functionality, what it can do is impressive. But getting to it, it's too complicated. But it's interesting. Like, I was just up at Lucid's design center or their headquarters, but I was in the design room. And yeah, they have like...
Don't tell me anything secret.
No, nothing secret. They had more drapes and boards blocking my view. But they said like, if you look just here, you can see like, here's our software engineers, here's our design team, here's materials, here's human interaction. You know what I mean? And they're all sitting in the same big giant studio. and they just run up and down the staircase all day and talk to each other.
That's like in Manhattan Beach. We got a quick tour, and you'd walk around, and like there's literally like the small paint. What do they call them? The little models. The
paint sample.
The paint sample models of the exterior. There's swatches of leather over here, and then you go into this other room, and everybody's got a big computer screen on, and they're like reproducing different parts of the
user experience. But I've been to like Detroit OEMs, and they're in different zip codes.
Right. And that's obviously the advantage of a startup, right?
Sure.
And the question is, how do you keep that energy? Yes. How do you scale keep that collaboration?
Scale
when you scale? Yeah. And that's going to be everybody's, challenge.
Yes.
So how do you do that? Because once you have, there's a difference between being 500 people and 50,000 people.
Yes. Yeah. Of course.
Okay. Yeah. So we're at a kind of a crossroads. We got a 30-minute
sign. Let's go to BMW.
Well, okay. Well, before we go there,
I have a good BMW.
We'll use this as an entry point because we just kind of obliquely mentioned, and this podcast is going to be out like a pretty far out a little bit, a couple months. Herbert Diess at VW just got, they parted ways, and it looks like the story is that the software piece, VW CARIAD is their software arm. A lot of delays across VW group. So the Bentley flagship EV apparently is delayed. The electric Porsche Macan delay. So this guy has got to go. Great. That was one big story in the news in the last few days. The other one was, I don't know if you saw this one, your former long time ago company, BMW in Korea, apparently was selling cars and trying to sell subscriptions to different features, like sea heaters. So it's like, so this is what SDV, this is what a software-defined vehicle, a potential future that it's going to unlock, which is potentially really cool features or more features within the car, but also interesting ways for manufacturers to monetize. Now, this story came out. The heater's in the car. BMW wants to sell you a subscription to it, and then outrage, right? Story pops up over here. We cover it. Wall Street Journal finally covers it, and then BMW North America has to release a statement and say, whoa, 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 we're not doing this. It's the guys over here. This is a terrible view. I think, can we agree that this is a terrible idea? And this is something MotorTrend, we're going to come out very strongly against. We love software. We love adding features to the car. But do not double bill us. Do not bill us through the perpetuity of our ownership experience for stuff that's already in the car. Where do you sit on the over-the-air updating?
By the way, that's not what I meant by BMW.
We're gonna go back. But
I think I have a more futuristic view on that, and I think you have to step back, and we can look at different appliances that we grew up with. Whether you picked up a phone, and how much did you pay for your phone in the old days? Not much. Now they also couldn't do anything.
Right.
And now you're buying a phone for $800 and there's not much in it. And now you can add a whole bunch of stuff and suddenly you're paying $150 a month for a phone. Or it used to be that you would turn on the TV and you would watch Western or action movie or whatever. Now you're turning it off and you not only do you have to pay $10 or $15 a month, but if you want the really good movie early on, you have to pay another five or $10 or $15.
Or $20. Yeah.
And if you want to see the latest boxing match, there's maybe even $50.
Yeah. Yeah.
So reality is that we are going to move into a subscription culture. Now, there is a couple of reasons why this is going to work. One is that the complexity, and I'm going to use the seat heater as an example. So the complexity of, for example, figuring out who wants seat heaters in the car means that you need to have a unique system in the factory that figures out which cars are we putting seat heaters in. That's number one. But then number two, think about some of these vehicles will actually in the future be subscription vehicles, meaning somebody subscribed to it, then it gets given to somebody else. So somebody in California says, I don't need seat heaters. That car eventually ends up in New York. And now nobody wants to own it or subscribe to it because it doesn't have seat heaters.
Right.
And on top of that, if you put seat heaters in 1 million cars, the same one versus just in 200,000 cars, those seat heaters become so cheap that you may not even really be charged for it because the one that's going to use the seat heater might be charged a little extra, so you don't really pay for it. So there's a lot of arguments why that eventually will work. Now, does it work right now? And I think this was more to do with communication.
True.
That the way that was communicated, I don't think was really smart. Sorry, BMW.
Right.
I think there's other ways to do that. But I think it's unavoidable that we're entering into this subscription culture. And part of it also is that we have different type of mobility options to us. You have car sharing,
right?
You have ride hailing. You're gonna have we're making a flexible lease where you can lease our car and give it back after, you know, a week if you want. So the point is that I think we're moving into a whole different type of using a vehicle where these vehicles have to be much more flexible,
right,
much more upgradable to be used for different scenarios. It's maybe a little tough to swallow right now, but eventually it'll just happen whether we like it
or
not.
That's a very good, that was an excellent point, which is the outrage comes from people viewing this as in the traditional ownership model, missing the idea that, and again, who knows if we're going to get to the fully shared economy where you can just walk up to a car that you have already selected through your mobile phone and paid for, rented, or whatever for some period of time. You get in, and then every option that you selected will then be turned on for you. And then if it goes to Johnny, he either wants more or less or whatever.
Right. I mean, let's also not forget we sort of live in, you know, sadly, like in an outrage culture. So like, subscription for seat heaters. Ah!
That's how we make our money.
I think everybody, but don't forget, everybody, of course, nobody likes to get charged for anything, right?
Sure.
We would like everything to be free, but reality is that there's nothing free. There's no free lunch.
Right.
And even and some sort of software upgrade, like some funny face on your screen. I'll give you an example. That has to be developed. Ten developers have to do it. They have to get paid. So it is not free, even though it seems free.
I'll give you an example. So I have a Rivian. Mm-hmm. And the other day I did an over-the-air update, and then it added a pet mode, right? So the idea is leave your animals in the car. Not only will it keep the temperature nice, but it'll real large on the screen. If you look in the car, you'll see it's at 72 degrees. So nobody will smash your window to like free the dogs. And I thought it was so cool. I have dogs. I was telling my friend and he's like, what a dumb feature, because like I don't have dogs. I would never put a dog in that car. And so that's one where it's like, well, I would pay whatever, 95 cents a month to whatever it is, you know, for something like that. So I see both sides. At the same time, if there's a seat heater, I hate the idea of driving around.
I think this is a very unique example.
There's probably other much better examples.
Yes. Well, there are.
That's a hardware. Hardware should work. Software should maybe subscribe.
The thing, I was talking with our new hire, Eric Tingwall, about this last night, and I was saying the thing that the legacy OEMs, they cannot do, and we're going to come out very strongly in favor of this line of thinking, is they cannot plan to, they can't have a monetization route for these feature upgrades. Like they can't like, hey, we're going to design the car and we're going to, ooh, in year two, we're going to roll this out and charge this much. I think that's the minute the consumer gets wind of like, you just found a way to milk money out of me over the life of this car. I think that's going to be a mistake. It's going to bite a lot of car companies in the butt. But that's just my take on it. Let's pause.
Who is this guy we're talking to?
Like, he was born in I'm going to butcher Allerød, Denmark, somewhere.
Allerød.
Okay. I have nothing from the time you were born until you went to Art Center Europe. So where does your love of cars come from?
You know, my father, believe it or not, was an electrical engineer.
Okay.
And he actually sold electric motors. Mm. And he actually had me build them when I was a kid because he got them from Germany to assemble. And he would then make them special for different things. And I remember hating being in his workshop and having to assemble all these electric motors.
Winding copper and stuff.
They came in pieces and we had to kind of put them together. And he was putting special things for special purposes, et cetera. But anyway, he had an old Saab 96. And I used to sit in the back seat of that, and I would just remember, you know, those before you had iPhones and all that stuff, so you would obviously had to do something else with your time. So I just remember looking at cars and starting to recognize as a kid any car at night, like on the tail lamps, I would know exactly which car it was. Mm-hmm. And I remember one day, I don't know how old I was, I must have been around maybe 10 or something, and or 8, something like that. And I saw this Maserati Bora, you know, the early 70s.
One. Wonderful car.
You know, it just passed us. And it had butterflies in my stomach. And I didn't really know why. It was just like, and in that moment, I just knew I was going to do something with cars. I didn't know if I was going to be washing cars, engineering right. cars, designing cars, selling right. cars. And quite frankly, at that moment, I didn't care.
Right.
So that was really how my... And then I start buying car magazines like MotorTrend, which usually when we got it in Denmark, it would be like 2 months old.
Right.
So, you know, that was those days. But, you know, so that was kind of how my affection and love. And I start trying to figure out, how do you become a car designer? You couldn't in Denmark because there was no car industry. And my teacher, when you went into, you know, what do you want to be kind of class, I said, I want to be a car designer. There's nothing called that. You can become an engineer. You can become an architect. I said, no, I want to be a car designer. You can't. It's just, shut up. So my father finally said, why didn't you write a letter to Volvo? Because it was like the closest.
Yeah, right. In Gothenburg. Sweden, yeah, yeah, yeah.
You know, next country over. And I said, look, I'll start in the factory. I'll sweep the floors. Just let me in. I'll learn. I'll do whatever. And they were, of course, like, forget it. But they said, hey, there's a school, an American school, called Arch and the College of Design in Pasadena in California. And they recommended that school. And at that time, fortunately, they had opened a branch in Switzerland. And I had got my first car, an old rusty Alfa Romeo Alfa Sud, which I never sold in the US.
Right? Yeah, I know Alfa Sud,
but it was a pretty amazing car with a boxer engine, and I got it tuned up to 125 horsepower and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. So I drove down to, I put all my drawings, drove down to Arch and the College of Design and got accepted, and that was it.
Where in Switzerland was this?
It was in Montreux.
Okay.
Which is sort of the French part.
The Geneva.
Is it still? Yeah. Is it still?
No. So then what happened was, you know, they kept it open for 5-6 years, and then they wanted to consolidate and just have one school here in Pasadena.
Okay. Right. Yeah. I looked that part up. The Volvo letter writing campaign was great. And then, but I was like, I didn't know Art Center was in Europe. I was looking around. And then I saw that eventually, I guess it was in Stuttgart at some point before they closed it down. Maybe, I don't know. But how.
Let's get to BMW. So you,
okay. So you did Art Center.
We're running out of time.
Yeah. You did Art Center.
BMW.
Did you do it? Is it an extern? How did you get into BMW? Did you do an externship? Or
no.
How did you...
So what happened was I really wanted to go to Alfa Romeo because I had an Alfa Romeo.
Okay.
And I drove over the Alps, got there, and you know, when I had my appointment, and of course, you know, the guy didn't show up, so I had to drive back.
But by the way, that's a classic Italian story.
I barely had you know, gasoline enough to get back because I had no money. I was a student and all that. And then actually what happens at Art Center is a lot of times you have the car companies coming in to interview. So I then went for, I hoped I had already got that job, but I didn't. So I had to so I interviewed with different, and somebody from BMW came in and his name was Klaus Kapitza. He designed the 8 Series, the first 8 Series.
Oh, right.
Mm-hmm.
And he was just.
E31.
That's right. Yeah. And he was running the, and that's where the Z1 was done.
Right.
And he had. You know, he was running that kind of advanced design studio, and he loved my drawing. Said, "Hey, do you want the job?" And I said, "Yes." He said, "You know, can you come to BMW and blah blah interviews?" I went to interview and all that, and they said, "Well, you know, we are the little special division here, so you're not really part of the lease program over at BMW, but we have like some test cars, and because you know I was getting rid of my car." And then he said, you know, I never forget that. I got the job, started, and somebody walked me down to the parking garage and like number 17 stall. There was like a 318 BMW. And I was like, oh, that's pretty cool. And, you know, I got in the car, got out, and I heard it sounded really strange. So, and it was some old test car. So I open up the hood and I see a big M. So it was a... undercover M3 getting tested.
Right.
I drove till 3 o'clock in the morning on the Autobahn.
Right.
I mean, it was nuts.
So you're coming out of an Alfa Sud into an M3.
Like, I must have had at least 200 something horsepower. I mean, it was just phenomenal.
And this is the E30 era. The original M3. And that really was a big motor in a little tiny car.
I was so excited. And I was like, I can't wait. I got in and my, you know, I'm starting working. And a couple of weeks, I did some fun work on a 5 Series and, you know, all kind of other things, you know, whatever, some smaller project.
And real quick, this is in Munich.
That's in Munich.
Okay.
And then finally came in and said, you kind of been selected to go on this program, mainly because nobody else wants to do it, and that is to make a BMW electric car. And I was like, oh, no. Like, nobody wanted right, to do right. it. It was 1989. Right. California had made a rule. 10% of all cars right. in California had to be electric by 1999.
Right.
And, of course, GM and Ford behind the scenes said, yeah, forget that. But BMW thought that was going to really happen. So they right. had,
well, Germans like rules.
They're
right?
like, yeah, hey, yeah, that's yeah. a rule. You got to yeah, make yeah. a car.
Right, right, right.
And a car could go 40 miles and 40 miles an hour.
Right.
And it was a tiny little thing, and, you know, it was just...
I just saw this car again. BMW now shows this as part of their legacy yeah, in yeah. EVs. Is it the green? Was it green?
It was a green and a red.
Right. Yeah, okay.
The red one is the one I worked on. That burned.
Okay.
And
okay.
the word That's was right. that when it burned and the BMW engineers were called in early in the morning, they start taking papers and throw it in the fire.
Make it burn more.
So, okay. That was a joke, by the way. Right, so right. don't kill anybody.
So 89. What was the name of that electric car?
It was called E1.
E1, right.
And then the green one, I believe, was E2.
Okay. So that was like your first big project, which is that's great. This is the Harkins.
I want to get
yeah,
to.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. So
let
what
me get to the yeah, Z8?
Just but
we got 15 minutes.
We got more than that. No, what happens?
Z8.
What other cars did you work on? Like, you don't just jump into the design of V8.
So what happened, I mean, look, I worked, obviously at BMW, you have, usually in these big car companies, you're making, I mean, sometimes you would do 10 full-size clay models competing on, let's say, a 3 Series or right. something like that. So I obviously was competing on different programs.
You were always exterior.
I was always exterior. Right. I loved exterior. That's sort of my, you know, that was just my passion. Mm-hmm. And we, you know, you also end up doing many internals. You know, we were working on a 6 Series coupe that never happened, like these right. beautiful cars that were put down the cellar, never done, because there was like a dip in the market. And the marketing said, we don't want a 6 Series coupe. And then I worked on the concept of the first X5. I was sent over here to the U.S. with a small team to kind of figure out why Americans like these big SUVs and what is it with these cup holders and what is a big gulp and all that. So we were driving through in and out and, you know, we were doing all this stuff to kind of figure out. So I was working on a little bit setting up the proportions on the first X5. I didn't design it. I did a proposal, but it was really about how do you get the bigger wheels out in the corners to make this more sporty and define right. what is. And as that happened, I had started a program it was really not a real program. It was really a development chief that had been in south of France, got down to try some different sports cars, and eventually they all came back to the board at BMW and said, why don't we have a sports car? Mm. You know, we used to have, and da-da-da, we had the M1, yeah. and then yeah. before that we had 507. Elvis drove it.
Sure.
So the brief kind of was just before summer vacation, as you know, there's like 4 to 6 weeks right. in Europe. And I planned with my at that time wife and 2 kids to go to the U.S. We had rented a camper. We're going to go all over U.S. for 4 weeks. And suddenly the design chief comes in. At the time it was Chris Bangle, and said, hey, we got this assignment. We have to kind of see how would a reimagination of a 507 look like? The 911 Porsche had evolved. And anybody want to do it? And everybody was like looking down because it was vacation. It was like end of July. And I was like, I'll do it.
But that's crazy because we've talked to a lot of designers over the years, and like the chance in a career to do a front engine rear drive 2-seater is almost non-existent.
Right. Yeah, but you have to remember this was not a real project. So we had many projects at right. BMW. Oh, so where hey, why don't you try and do this?
So this was seen as like we got to make this one guy happy.
We got to show this to the board. Right, you know, they've right. asked for it. How would it look? So I came home to my ex-wife and said, look, you know, there's some good news and some bad news. The good news is I won this amazing project. The bad news is we got to cancel our U.S. wow, you know, wow. trip.
Yeah.
So obviously that was not happy times there. But as I started working on it, I got some engineers that they had assigned me. And it was a very small group. We were like 5 people. We quickly did a full-size model. And because there was no platform, I was free. So it was kind of like a dream, but I was so, I believed in this car.
Right. Right.
So I was so set. So I said to the engineers, whatever I do, please tell me if it's impossible.
Right.
And if it's nearly possible, let's solve it. And the most difficult part was the rear end and solving bumpers and other things. And it happened so that one of the engineers had some old sports cars. So he brought them in. I said, look, and can you imagine if we can solve this problem? So I really, you know, motivated everybody a lot to kind of get on this program and take it serious. So it ended up that engineers actually had an idea of how could we make this car if somebody wanted it. And we ended up with this clay model and dynocked, which means sort of painted and all that stuff. And it was then shown to the development chief at the time, Wolfgang Reitzler. And he said, oh, we got to do this car.
Okay.
And he said, let's build a quick product, like a nice show car. We show it to the board. We have a meeting in whatever, 3 months. We build it, drove it in, and everybody's just like, is this a program? No, but let's build it. We just do it.
Right, right.
And it actually is maybe one of, I would say it's probably the only car I've done in my career at a big car company where nothing was changed except for one thing.
What was that?
That was, I had a faster windscreen.
Okay.
And Pitchens Reader was chairman at the time, and he had a 507. He came and sat in the car, and he goes, in my 507, my head is much further away from the header, I want this moved off. So we had to move it up in the last moment, which unfortunately meant that the turbulence was not quite as good as it would have been if it was faster. That was the only thing that was changed to the car.
I mean, I got to say, you know, as a student of design, I mean, that's one of the all-time beautiful cars, especially when a lot of times, like, hey, let's do a new Beetle. Like, okay, I could see the relationship. But you wouldn't even necessarily know this is a modern 507. It's just a beautiful standout car in its own right. I mean, it really is.
Just, well, if you're listening right now on your iPhone, just open BMW up Chrome Z8. And just Google search BMW Z8.
And BMW E39 M5 motor and manual transmission.
Right.
So yeah, right. Pretty cool.
Very, very nice to...
So,
Little power.
Okay, so that is circa, that's like the last thing you, the big project you did with BMW. That's like 2000.
Yeah.
Right? Did you meet Mark Clark at BMW?
Yeah, of course.
Okay.
So,
old guys.
Yeah.
So then you go.
Adrian van Hooydonk. We started at the same time at BMW, went over to what they call the Hook House, and we got the badge the same day. We were these two young guys starting at BMW, and now he's design
chief. Still there,
at BMW.
Yeah.
So and then so you go to Aston Martin in 2001 through 2005. Now we're gonna talk a little bit about Aston Martin, but what's really interesting that I realized in this research piece is that while you were at BMW, James Bond, the Pierce Brosnan James Bond, was driving BMWs. And then shortly after you go to Aston Martin,
he's back
the Daniel,
in Aston's,
the Daniel Craig James Bond is driving Aston Martins. Did you ever, and Z8 was in.
Z8 was a Bond car.
Was a Bond not car. Enough.
Right.
Yeah, and that's,
did you have any connection with that? Did you get to work on that
it's
at all?
It's all me behind the scenes.
Oh, come on.
Kidding.
Oh, dang it.
You know what the best part was of that was I got to go to the Bond after parties and see all the Bond girls. That was pretty amazing.
So that was like marketing or somebody else did that? Because my understanding is the Z8s that they used, they were all like show car. Like,
well, the story of that was that BMW signed some deals for 3 Bond movies, and then you remember it was first a C3.
Yep.
And then it was a 7. And then I don't know what other car was the third that was supposed to be, but it wasn't a C8. And I guess the director of the car, of the Bond movie, walked through the design studio to go over to see that other car, and he saw the C8 and he says, "I want
that's
that."
That's for James Bond.
And BMW said, "Look, it's not ready," and he said, "I don't care, I want it." So they had to build some fiberglass models, and you can kind of see it when you look at the movie and you see when it gets cut. You can see it's fiberglass and not, aluminum.
It gets cut in half.
Yeah, it gets cut in half.
Right. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So then what they did was they filmed the scene where it was Pierce Brosnan. So they filmed the scene when he drove. They had to film at the very end to get the first prototype to the Bond set. And if you notice, he has a very weird way of holding the steering wheel. He has crossed his arms, which you would never drive like that. And the reason is they didn't even have time to put that special sender where he's firing the rocket. That wasn't done.
Oh, right.
So he had to cover off the center of the steering wheel while he was driving. So those are, little movie stuff there.
Okay.
So how'd you get from BMW to Aston Martin?
So I was kind of headhunted there.
Of the Z8?
I think, Aston had just been bought by Ford. Yeah. And I think they needed to do a major turnaround. You know, Aston, weren't making money. They were selling at that time, I think, between 2 models, the DB7 and the Vanquish, like 1,300 cars a year.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
You know, And they need a real revival. They hired a new CEO in Ulrich Betz.
Yep.
So basically, I was contacted, and I had no intention really of leaving BMW, to be quite honest. But it was a funny thing because I got two calls, one from Jay Mays, which were head of Ford.
Yeah, we know Jay, yeah.
And then I got one call from Aston Martin. And I thought it was for the same job, but at the same time, Jay wanted me to be chief designer of Ford and Aston Martin. So it ended up that I kind of got two jobs. It wasn't chief designer of Ford, but it was to open a Ford design studio in London called Ingenie.
Oh, sure. Yeah.
And then it was...
famous design studio.
Yeah, and then it was going on sort of the board of directors of Aston, being part of a turnaround team, and then also, of course, design director. And, you know, the reason I got convinced was really because, you know, the whole thing happened actually at the Formula One Grand Prix in Monaco, where I bumped into Ulrich and so on and Wolfgang Reichler, and they basically said, hey, do you want to design the next two Aston Martins?
Yeah.
I mean, you just can't say no to that, right?
How do you say no, right? And again, it goes back to it's very rare because most of the times you're designing sedans and SUVs and minivans.
And, right. And at big car companies, you might design something that never gets produced. So you lose some global competition or something.
But, you know, everyone, you'll remember, you know, the DB9 and the Vantage, they're just forever cars.
Right.
They
are. Also, Bond cars. Did you have any input into those vehicles being? Because those ended up being in Daniel Craig's.
That was a DBS.
The DBS is really a continuation of the DB9,
right?
With sort of a body kit on it, or whatever you want to say, more hips.
Okay. Well, and before we can move off James Bond, I just need to know who is the best James Bond in your book? Which your favorite 007?
George Lazenby.
No, you know, I liked Pierce Brosnan a lot. I think he was super elegant. And then I liked Daniel Craig. I mean, even though they're very different, I like both of them. And I'm really intrigued to see who's going to be the next Bond. I mean, I think it's tough because both of them I thought was really good. They kind of had that whole British gentleman, suave and all that. So it's going to be, I'm a big Bond fan. I have every Bond movie. I have Bond posters, of course, from World Not Enough.
Right.
So I'm really excited. I didn't like the end of the last Bond movie. I don't know why he had to get killed, but I'm still thinking he didn't really get killed.
Yeah, you know.
I think they're just, that was the end of Daniel Craig's time as James Bond.
Yeah.
He got married at some point. I mean, they do all kinds of stuff to poor Bond.
So,
all right, but then from there... You found your own car company. No. You did
Coach Build. It's a
Coach Build. Yeah,
Fisker Coach Build, which is your design.
That was Newport Beach
on existing chassis. Essentially,
we'll move fast over that.
Yeah, 2005.
That was something that I thought. You know, coming from the big car industry, you as many not me and as many other people, you know, you think that it can't be that difficult to go out and do stuff. So I went out and because I'd never really, of course, taken care of manufacturing and all this other stuff. And I started with a business partner, and we started making these specialty cars, and it turned out it was much more difficult than we thought.
And they were Mercedes SLs and BMW 6 Series.
Yeah, we used, of course, the platform. We wanted to kind of reinvent Coach Build. And we had some small investors that kind of said, hey, do it. It's going to be great. And finally I said, okay, you know, I've been at Aston, and I've done these two cars, and I kind of felt, you know, I'm fairly young. I'm under 40. I can't imagine myself just sort of sitting on a beach drinking martinis for the rest of my life and, you know, or managing other people. I love design. So when I left, I mean, the entire industry said, what an idiot, you know, leaving the best job in the world. And I was pretty excited about it until, you know, you go to the toilet and there's no toilet paper and you're going, why is there no toilet paper? Well, you have to go and buy it. Nobody's putting it there.
Right.
So it was a lot harder to start your own company than I thought. We sold some cars, but then it was very difficult, of course, to service them, deal with customers, because when you hand build stuff, it was really, really difficult. We did sell, of course, some cars, and we learned a lot. But eventually, you know, we then turned to what's, you know, starting Fisker Automotive.
Right? But you went from like, wow, this is really hard, to something much harder. I mean, I got it right. Fisker Automotive had to be orders of magnitude more difficult than the Coach Build.
It was, but you know, one of the learnings from the Coach Build was you're up against all these traditional car makers doing another traditional car. Right? Whereas with Fisker Automotive, I really felt we were doing something so revolutionary and new. You know, it was kind of the world's first luxury, environmental-friendly car.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, that whole inspiration came from, you know, Leonardo DiCaprio driving to the you know, with a Prius to the Oscars, and I thought, hey, this guy's got to be able to afford a better car than that. Right. So that's kind of why we, and I thought that's really something.
I've seen
there.
His boat. He could afford a better car than that. Yeah. Yeah.
So that's kind of how why we started Fisker Automotive. And I thought it was a very, you know, a totally different thing, but there was nothing like it. So right. I felt this was really the right. And I also had, in the meantime, specifically working in Germany and Europe, there was a lot more opposition to cars.
Sure.
You know, you have a lot of opposition to cars in big cities. Sure. These cities are not designed for cars like LA.
Yeah.
There's a lot of congestion, but there's a lot of pollution.
Right. Sure.
So I kind of grew up hearing constantly how politicians want to ban cars, and we saw them getting banned or fined in cities. Right. So I
congestion charge in London.
Yeah.
But also like European cities are covered in diesel soot, which we don't have diesel here.
Exactly. Yeah, that was the other thing. So I really started thinking coming, you know, growing up in Denmark, which is a very sort of green-minded, sustainable country. You know, my mother always told me to pull the lights off when I left the room, et cetera. So I felt, why can't we make a sustainable, clean car? Because I love cars, and I cannot imagine a world without cars.
Same.
So how do we change the car industry? So it kind of was a twofold thing where I also was driven by this desire to reinvent the car industry and kind of figure out not just making electric car, but how can we use sustainable materials, recycled materials. So it was such a passion for me. And right. you know, quickly we had people join the company that had the same passion. So that was kind of this excitement that happened at that moment in time. But we were probably too early, clearly.
You know, Can I ask you a question real fast? I've wanted to ask you this since, many years now. Should the Fisker Karma should have been a pure EV? Would your life be different now if you had said we're an electric car company rather than a plug-in hybrid range extender
so
company?
So hindsight is always
yes,
easy.
Yes, hindsight is very easy.
You must remember that we were much earlier out with this vehicle than, let's say, the Tesla Model S.
I remember.
So so when we were developing the Fisker Karma, we did not have a battery technology that would have given us 200 or 300 mile range. You know, so we didn't really have that technology. So that's why I said we were probably too early.
Got it.
It was even early from the thing of being a plug-in hybrid. It was really a electric vehicle with a range extender.
Because
the gasoline engine wasn't powering the wheels.
It was it was like the Chevy Volt.
Yeah.
Type thing.
And if you think about it, you have hybrids, plug-in hybrids today that has 20 mile range and electric. At that time, we had almost 50 miles of range,
right?
Which is a lot. We were the first to use such a large lithium-ion battery. So, you know, we were very early out. We were probably a year or probably 2 years too early. And if we would have waited 2 years and made it electric, yes, it would look different. But, hey, you know, it is what it is.
Well, what's interesting is it's kind of, I was thinking about this, it's kind of your experience with the coach building side on top of, as you mentioned, like a Volt chassis with a larger battery. So you, and which I get, this is sort of that, how do we solve for Leonardo DiCaprio's terrible dilemma in going to the Oscars, right? Let's give him a beautiful bodied car on top of what's sort of like a Prius.
To bring some beautiful bodies home back to his boat with, yeah.
But the really interesting thing, as you pointed out, we were chatting about this, is that the design is so enduring. In fact,
such a strong design.
After you exited Fisker Automotive in 2013, you basically held on to that body through subsequent
VLF.
And then ultimately into VLF, where let's forget the range extender. Let's just put a big old V8 in there.
No, V10, right?
Well, started with the V8. But that I think came from, and this I've been dying to ask you because it's one of my personal heroes, probably the input of Mr. Maximum Bob Lutz, right? Like that's VLF was Villarreal, Lutz, and Fisker.
So, you know, that whole thing really was three guys getting together and having fun at the bar,
right?
Kind of thing.
Yeah.
I remember sitting in a Mexican restaurant. I drew up the logo with Bob, and he goes, "Yeah, that's it. Can you raise up the L a bit?"
Right.
Okay. So it was VL.
Yeah, yeah.
Is that fine? You know, he was a grandmaster and still is. So you know, it was really about three guys just doing what the hell we wanted, having fun, right. And you know, they had a workshop, and you know, we had. So they had already done some work on this vehicle. Then we did a couple of other vehicles like the Force One, where we get a race car driver in. So it was really just about having fun. And I was sort of, at that time thinking, what am I going to do with my career? You know, I've just, you know, had this most terrible time with Fisker Automotive and all that stuff, and had left the company, which again, I didn't own, but right. I had put all my money in that company. I really had nothing.
Sure.
So also for me, it was about, hey, I need to actually put some food on the table and pay the rent. You know, I left Fisker Automotive with only one thing. I went and bought a Fisker Karma the night before, where I could still prove I had a salary, because I knew next day I would leave the company and I wouldn't be able to finance a car. And I slept in that car as well. So, so that was really like rock bottom, and then coming back up. And Bob and I had already always sort of bumped into each other at various car shows. Right. He admired my designs, and I just kind of admired his straightforwardness in the car industry and his love for design and
performance,
as a car guy and everything else. So when we got together there, we just had a lot of fun. I don't know that we ever had an idea that it was going to be a giant business. We did a few different projects, and then eventually we kind of just, okay, that's it, we've done it, sort of thing.
Yeah.
But it was fun to work with Bob, because I never did. I can tell you a funny story I've never told anybody.
Please.
Perfect.
We love love stories.
Now, this is a top secret. I might not be able to show up in Detroit for a while.
Okay, it's fine.
That's okay.
So basically, I was at Ford, and Bob... with Ford, Aston Martin.
Yeah.
And Bob wanted to hire me as chief designer of Cadillac. Hmm. And I was staying at the Ford Hotel. What's it called in Dearborn?
I've stayed there. Yes.
The one they own.
Yes.
And Bob said, hey, you got to come over to GM and, our big building, and we'll have an interview and you'll meet. Ed Wilburn was there at the time.
Yeah.
And we'll have dinner. And I said, okay, I'll go. No, he said, I'll send my car. I said, I don't know. It's a Ford Hotel. Yeah. No, don't worry about it. So how do I know it's your car? I'll send somebody in. Okay, so I'm sitting there in the lobby, and suddenly I see this white Cadillac, clearly Bob's car, and I'm like, what am I going to do? So I'm like sneaking out, hoping nobody sees me slipping into this white Cadillac, and it drives me to GM, and under some secret entrance, get me in, and to this elevator. We get all the way up in the top, whatever that big restaurant.
Coach House. Coach House is somewhere else. Yes.
I know. There was one table in the middle of the room, and there was like four waiters. And
you could smoke cigars there, I'm sure.
Yeah, it was pretty amazing. So that was these heydays, which was kind of cool. And it was very, very tempting. But I was like, I can't leave Aston Martin. I'm not quite finished with the car. So I never ended up taking the job. But I ended up working a little bit with Bob later, which was a lot of fun.
That's great. I love it. That's like the kind of the big Detroit era of.
It's also fun. I mean, I remember years before I had the MotorTrend job, I was in software, and I was working for GM's legal department, and I would fly in every week from New York, where I used to live, and I go work there, and I like cars, and every time I go to Enterprise or whatever, I rent a car, and they had a Subaru. I'm like, I'll rent a Subaru. That'll be different. And I pull in. They're like, you can't bring that to GM. I go, what? They go, no, you cannot park that in our lot. Like,
lots
go,
over there.
Yeah, go park on the street. Hope it doesn't get broken into, which it will. This is before they were in the rent center. This is when they were kind of out in the sticks. But anyways, that's a very – I love that. Like, someone might see you getting a Cadillac. Oh, no.
So we covered a lot of the Fisker current product, and we're rapidly running out of time. How does the Phoenix rise from the ashes?
That's like, my – how do you get this – have the strength? Because you said you have a lot of ups and downs, but how do you get back up again after something goes so wrong?
Well, I think – I don't think it matters who you are. I think everyone in life have – things that doesn't go their way. Mm. And then I think we all have something we're pretty good at. Maybe it's the one thing that we make our life with. And, I would die of starvation if I would try to become a singer or a writer. I know how to design cars. And for me, it was like the only thing to turn back to. I also felt I had something to give back to society, quite frankly, specifically when it comes about sustainability. And that's why it's such a passion of mine to bring this in to what we're doing at Fisker Inc. right now. We have set this incredible goal up to make a CO2 neutral car by 2027.
And which is coming up.
Well, and everybody pretty much says it's impossible. And it might be, but I want to put that goal anyway. Yeah. And we have hired a head of this program, head of ESG, We're going out suppliers. I mean, it's
we're also building the car in Austria.
Well, that's the Ocean, but the next the pair will be built in Ohio.
Oh, okay.
So you know, we got that collaboration with Foxconn, and I think that CO2 neutral car will be a version of the pair, which will be that sub $30,000 car. It's radical. It's different. It's probably the biggest risk I've ever taken design wise in my life.
Okay.
It's totally different. But it's also...
When are we going to see it?
So because it's so different, it's kind of a vehicle we don't really want to show too early. We want to do it very late.
Okay.
So probably, I'm thinking late next year, it's going to go into production around mid-24.
Okay.
All right, well, maybe it looks like we're getting to the last question. I have a last question. All right, you go first.
Okay. So I'll just do a follow-up on that and then my last question.
All right.
Is there any news you want to break here on Pear? Or, look, we covered Ocean. We're excited. We see you on Instagram test driving it.
And it looks good. It does look good on the street.
It's the right size for America. It's an SUV. We love SUVs. Pear is going to be this mind-blowing thing. Anything you want to tell us about Pear, the next version to watch out for?
Well, I think what I want to tell you about the Ocean is that I think it surprised all of us, even our engineering team. The way it drives, the way it handles, what we have been able to achieve in this so fast. And I think, right now we're talking about, again, not reducing volume, but actually increasing volume of this vehicle, because we are seeing a daily uptake in reservations, which is incredible. I think we have over or close to 60,000 reservations now, which is quite amazing, because that's from people who's... Many of them have never seen the car in reality.
Yeah.
They've never sat in it. They've never driven it.
It's 5,000 to reserve, too.
Well, we have, that's the first 5,000. It's 5,000 non-refundable.
Right.
And we're pretty much, done with that. So again, and I find, in the end of the day, the car industry is about product.
Yeah.
You can say whatever you want about marketing and smart, fancy ideas and upgrades and OTA and this and that. It's about how do I love this car or not?
Right.
So, and I think that is going to become even more prevalent in the future, because it also used to be, hey, how does the car sound? How easy is it to shift the gear? How's the kick down? Well, all these things are disappearing with electric cars. So what is going to become more and more important is design, user interface, and connectivity.
Yep.
And then what is left is, how do we now get people emotionally involved into the car? How does it feel to drive it? How do I feel about this car? And that's going to be the trick, because we can use the old trick of the sound of the engine.
Right. So this plays into my question, which is a Z8 EV. I've seen a couple ideas for electric sports cars, but like an electric actual roadster where there's no top, where wind in your hair... Can that exist? Because maybe Polestar showed that
Tesla.
No, but it's not a roadster. It's a coupe that they call a roadster for some reason. And it's weird looking. I mean, there's a sensualness to the Z8, which I really, it's timeless, right?
Well, first of all, I'll probably get a Z8 and change it into an electric. Most likely,
okay,
just for the fun of it.
Yep.
But coming to sports cars and electric, I think that the sports car is the most difficult right now to handle this transition.
Because
it was so much based on this, noise and sound from the engine and shifting gears
and
all that.
That's where the pushback comes. Because I always tell people, they go, "Oh, I don't." And I go, "Do you really care if your Toyota Corolla is electric? Do you really care?"
Exactly.
Well, no, but my,
But the supercar and sports car, yes. So, however, we are spending a lot of time at Fisker. I'm spending a lot of time. We just have, opened a engineering center in UK called Magic Works with an ex Aston Martin guy running it, engineer. And we are developing what we think is one way of a future electric sports car. It's not a super small roadster. And the reason is, right now, the battery technology will
it's
make
heavy.
It's heavy. It wouldn't fit like in a Miata-sized car at this point.
You would get
no range. Right. So, but also, I'm thinking that maybe the sports cars needs to change. Why? Because even though we all love sports cars, even those who can afford supercars, they still ended up buying a super SUV.
Mm-hmm. Yes,
right?
Yes.
So how do we then convince people to go back in a sports car? And I think it needs to be slightly more usable.
Hmm.
I think it needs to adapt to where society is going. And so we are doing that with Project Ronin, which we might show later this year. I think it's going to be a phenomenal. It's more of a GT, to be quite honest.
That's fine. Yeah.
But it will be fully open, and it'll have usability like you've never seen before of a convertible. So you can drive it every day. You can drop the kids in school, all that stuff. And so I think there will be some new interpretations, and maybe the biggest change in the actual layout and what we're doing is going to happen in the sports car segment. So far, what I've seen is kind of mid-engine looking electric vehicles. Where I'm like, why? I mean, there's a reason for the mid-engine look, but why would you do that with
an EV?
You
don't need to. Yeah, if you don't need to. Right.
I guess my point is, you know, the Z. I remember the first time I saw the Z8, it took my breath away. But the one that really stands out in my head, and I'll never forget, it was the original press photo of the Vantage, and it was a perfect angle. It was on like, you know, I think it was a German road. It was supposed to look English, but it was very green. I still can see it. I mean, this is almost 20 years ago, and I see. And the only other car I've ever felt that way, just looking at a picture of it, was. Do you remember that? It wasn't a good car, but the Alpha 8C.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
The press photos like just blew me away. And well, but do we ever get that kind of emotion?
Yeah. Look, I think when you see the Ronin, you're gonna get that emotion.
All right,
I guarantee
good.
It.
Great.
That for me is my best work when it comes to pure. Sexy, beautiful, amazing lines and sculpture.
You're
proportion.
Able to, because the other one, just real quick, since you're here, I'm kind of fanboy
like,
a little bit. Let me fanboy a little bit, but like I remember the first time I saw a DB9 in traffic, I was on the 110 downtown heading to, you know, south, and the hips of the DB9, I couldn't believe what I was looking at. I'd never seen anything that sexy on the road. It was just, you know, the sun was hitting it. It was just the hips.
I think, you know, it's also, you know, sports cars are all about proportions.
Yes.
And what's happening is that normal cars become a lot better. So in my view, the proportions of the sports car now have to change and become more dramatic because, you know, they don't stand out enough from a Toyota Supra and other cars like that.
Right. All right. Enough. Are you done fanboying?
No.
Okay. I got a serious final question.
All right. Mm-hmm.
All right. Pebble Beach is coming up. Mm. Okay. Let's cast our mind forward though. 100 years. 2122. Okay. They want to do some sort of weird retrospective back at this turning point that has really encompassed your career. The transition from internal combustion into hybrid, plug-in hybrid, EVs, whatever. Okay. What is on the lawn? What is on the lawn at Pebble Beach in 100 years? That sort of captures this moment in time from a, you know, whatever Pebble likes, the design, the beauty, the importance.
Value.
Sure. And it can't be one of your designs.
I was about to say the Fisker Ronin.
Is there anything out there that you're just like, boy, that's going to go down in history as...
So I think that right now it's probably more about the technology than design,
okay.
Unfortunately, which is why we really try to push design. So it's a really hard... you know, I think actually what's going to be on the lawn is somebody talking about how many billions of ridiculous money was spent of trying to take the steering wheel out of a car in 2022.
So the Google Firefly is what he's saying, the little pod that they built in 2015. And
that's a great answer.
That's a good answer.
That's a great answer.
All right. Well, listen.
Henrik,
so glad to have you. We're going to have you back when you can talk more
about
when we can drive the Ocean, after we drive the Ocean, and we can look at more details on the pair.
And the Ronin.
Yes.
Absolutely.
Pleasure having you. Thank you so much.
Great to be here. Good talk to car guys.
Thank you.